Hey guys, so this is just a tutorial into showing how you can create and manipulate edible patterns and splines in Grasshopper and Rhino, and then importing them into 3ds Max to then manipulate the geometry and create maybe a pavilion, and then setting apertures based on attractor points, opening and closing surfaces. I guess the main reason why I wanted to show you this was because you can create patterns and stuff in 3ds Max itself, but I wanted to show you its versatility in importing other in its multi-platform based software abilities, where Grasshopper could create a bit more interesting or even versatile patterns than 3ds Max, where 3ds Max would then you do the grunt work. So I guess in Grasshopper today, we're just going to be creating a Voronoi pattern, a simple Voronoi pattern, just creating a simple script. I'll just take you through that really quickly and seeing how it works. So I guess we'll just a rectangle, just creating a bounding rectangle. Surface, so then we can find our populate geometry. Cool. Now we select how many points within this geometry. Let's say 50. I just wanted to make clear that any patterns or any geometries can be put into 3ds Max as well. I can't stress how important that is. Or how life-changing that is really. So let's create Voronoi. I guess I take a little bit of chance to talk about what a Voronoi is. Voronoi is pretty much just like soap bubbles, where the radiuses of the circles at each point, whenever they get large and the end points of the diameters touches the radius of the circles, they start to conjoin like exactly like soap bubbles and creating these interesting pockets and patterning. So I guess I can show you. So what happens is, yep. So as you can see, each individual circle starts off as a circle, but as it increases, it touches, it clings onto each other, and then therefore it creates this interesting shape. So what we can do there is, then we can create the bounds as a rectangle. And there you go, we have our Voronoi shape set to a bound. So what we're gonna do is bake this. Okay. Bake. Cool. So we turn this off. And then we select duplicates just to make sure there's none in the model scene. And then we set our geometry set point to the Z axis. Just make sure everything is coplanar, so when we bring it into 3ds Max, there's no issue. So once we got our curves and splines, we can select them and we can export that. So when you export things from Rhino, you can have a variety of different outputs. In this case, we're playing with splines and curves, so we just save them as a DWG to be able to import them into 3ds Max. So we just say there's Voronoi test one. Yes. Awesome, cool. Now that is a DWG. We can go into 3ds Max now and we can import that file. Desktop, flexible air modeling, and Voronoi test one, open. Right, when we get to the import stage, importing DWGs, when we import, sorry, we have different options, especially for DWGs. When we import them, we've got to make sure that they're set to the right income file units. So in the system file, we're working with meters, so we set that to meters and we rescale. It's also important to note that to set the derived AutoCAD parameters by layers, blocks, and nodes hierarchy. This is so then 3ds Max won't freak out and it won't select individual lines and instead be grouped in by blocks. We also need to weld nearby vertices so they are clean our surfaces and aren't chaotic. And then we click OK, and there we have our Voronoi surface. We change that color, just because you can't see it. Let's say pink, I like pink. Cool, so now we have our Voronoi surface. What we can do now is we can, because we imported it as layers node by hierarchy, it converts it into one singular surface. So we can change that name into Voronoi. So now that we change it into a Voronoi, what we can do now as an editable spline, what we can do now is we can start manipulating this surface to however we want it to look. So we just select that and then we go bend. So with bend, we can bend it along its X, Y, and Z axis based on angle and direction. Let's start by bending it on its X direction. As you can see, we can start bending it, flapping out and flapping it under. It's just about finding that particular shape that we really want and what is interesting. I think that's a bit cool. Down, we can further manipulate that by have layering modifiers on top of each other. Do that by the y-axis, curve that over, kind of like creating a shell-like structure, touching it at various points. Maybe we want to bend that along its center. We select center, changing that angle, making it kind of sort of realistic in a way. Maybe we want it in more. Maybe we bend this a little bit out. It's a bit intense, a bit tight of a curve. Oops. Maybe that's a little bit interesting to us. We'll change this. That's kind of cool, I guess. Cool, I think I'm gonna go with this one. What we can also do, because it's just, if we wanna have dissipate this a little bit more, displace this a little bit more, we can add a noise on top of it. Noise, this is just to disrupt this patterning surface and create a bit more of an interesting poly surfaces. So what we can do is we can fractal it and move it along its X axis and its Z axis and Y axis, just to kind of change up and make it a bit more chaotic and rock-like, so it's not so smooth and boring. Cool. I think that's kind of cool here. Maybe a little bit smooth on the edge. It's touching at three main points, and I'm pretty happy with that. However you like, I guess. Well, if we like that kind of geometry, but we want to edit the poly surfaces even more, so then we create more interesting apertures when we wanted to close and open them, we can go mesh smooth. Cool. Alright, so now we have our mesh smoothing tool. What we can do is we can convert classic edge versus default shading, turn wireframe override. What we can do now is we can mesh smooth. Doing so, we can start manipulating the poly surfaces themselves. So we can turn that into classic. That will kind of create a bit more of an interesting poly surface. So when we create our apertures, it'll be a lot more interesting. We can change the strength of this, change the undulations. I think that's kind of cool. Can change more and less. I guess in this case, less is more. Cool. I think I'm happy with this kind of paddling system going on here. So now that we've done this and we've kind of edited our poly splines and stuff like that, it's time we can now start playing with these apertures and turning it into a poly.